Good evening and a very warm welcome to this service at Bethel Baptist Church, Tredegar. My name is Steve Carter, one of the members, and I do, on behalf of the church, give you a very warm welcome. A few notices for the coming week. On Wednesday, there's a start of Christianity Explored. What is it? Well, it's a course of about 3-6 weeks designed to explain the gospel, but in an informal way so that questions can be asked without fear of any intimidation. And it's ideal for those as Christians who want to brush up on an understanding of the faith. And it's also designed for those who are not Christians as yet, but are attracted to its teaching and wants to know more. So I'd urge you not to be shy. You do this online and get in touch with Pastor Tristan or our elder, and they will give you all the details you need. So that's Wednesday evening. I think it's 7 o'clock, but just check. And then on Thursday, there's the prayer meeting, and that's at 7 o'clock for sure. And you'd be most welcome to join us. Then next Sunday, the preaching will be taken and the service is led by our pastor, Tristan Hallam. So if you need any more details, then just get in touch with Tristan or Clyde Jones, our other elder. Will you now join me as we commit our service to God? Father in heaven, we thank you that this is the day you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you that in the evening of the day, Adam walked with God. And we pray that we may know something of walking with you as we lift our voices to sing your praise, as we read and then hear your word, as we give our amen to prayers offered. We pray that all these things will bring to us your presence in a much nearer, deeper, real way. And as we pray for ourselves, we pray for all fellowships at this time, Tredegar and throughout Wales, that you would draw near to your people, show us something of your glory and do us good for all eternity. And it's in the name of your risen Son, Jesus Christ, we ask these mercies. Amen. Our opening song hymn is All People That on Earth Do Dwell, Sing to the Lord with Cheerful Voice.
Sing to the Lord with cheerful voice.
turn to the Bible for our reading. It's from the New Testament and from the second epistle or letter of Paul to Timothy, chapter 1. Paul has left Timothy in charge of the church at Ephesus, a newly planted church. Let's hear God's word. 2 Timothy 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, in keeping with the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve as my ancestors did with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me as prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we've done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Saviour, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel, I was appointed an herald and an apostle and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am. Yet this is no cause for shame, because I know whom I have believed, and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. May God bless the reading and hearing of his word. We now seek God together as we pray. Father, again, we thank you for your word in this world with all its confusing voices. We thank you for the voice of truth. Thy word is truth. We thank you that we're exhorted to meditate upon your word day and night. To not be like those who sit, walk or stand as cynics and as mockers. We thank you for the blessing of your word, that it gives light and life to our hearts and lives. Many of us can testify how we bless you for the day you arrested us, you taught us true wisdom, and our lives have been the better for knowing you and following you. Heavenly Father, whenever we come into your presence, we are conscious of your holiness and by contrast, our sinfulness. We have to cry out again, the good that we want to do, we find we don't always do. And what we shouldn't do, we find ourselves doing. So Lord, we confess our sins of thought, word and deed to you. But Lord, though we are aware of our sin, we would not be overcome by it. We would look to that hill of Calvary. We would thank you that your son died, the just for the unjust, for people like me, for people like us, so that our guilt may be removed, that our sinful record might be erased, that we might become new creatures in Christ Jesus, that your spirit might enter our lives and give us power the more to follow you, to love you, and to obey your word. Lord, we thank you then that there is still no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. and we come with rejoicing that we are still your children, that you still love us, that you still lavish your love upon us, that you delight when we come to that fountain that is open for sin and uncleanness, and you wash us afresh. So we would stand uncondemned, clean before you and before the world because of the amazing sacrifice of your Son. We thank you for every good and perfect gift of this past week, acknowledging it comes down from you, the Father of light, with whom there's no shadow caused by turning, for food and clothing, for friends, for family, for the degree of material goods that we have. We want to thank you and give you the praise, and ask that we, for our part, will be good stewards of our time and our money for the extension of your kingdom. And Lord, we would pray for your kingdom. You commanded, Lord Jesus, that your church go into all the world and preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, with the promise that you are with your people always. So we thank you for the church in China and the church in South Africa, in all of Africa, including South Africa. We thank you for the church in South America, and the church throughout the world. And in many cases, it is knowing fierce persecution. And we thank you for groups like Release International and Barnabas Aid that inform us for our prayers and our giving. And we thank you for the many heroic stories of your people standing fast. Be with them this day, Lord, we pray. Be they in prison, be they under surveillance. Grant that they will always, always remain faithful to you. Lord, we remember that little song, Lord, use me. Here am I, use me. Across the street or across the sea. Lord, here am I, use me. We pray for our individual witness in this secular age, yet an age that is in so much pain, that is blinded and lost. And we pray, Lord, that you would build your church in Tredegar, in Ebervale, in these valleys, that you would have mercy again, and you would bring people from darkness to light. To that end, help us to keep sowing God's word, to keep on keeping on. We pray, Lord, for friends, family and neighbours, that you would bring those who don't yet know you into an experience of eternal life. We pray, Lord, for all of Wales at this time of COVID-19. We thank you for the vaccine being distributed. We thank you for the work of the NHS. We thank you for your common grace in these days, and pray for all who are seeking to deal with this epidemic. And we pray, Lord, that as we see the uncertainty of this life, we may recognize the need to be right with you, that after death it is appointed unto mankind once to die, and then the judgment, and to appear before the judgment seat of God. Oh Lord, we don't want to appear there with great fear. We want to appear there with great joy, having believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, within the fellowship, for one and another, we think of Maya again, think of Adrian, we think of others who are going through examinations, we think of those whose operations have been postponed, and ask that you give them great grace. Lord, you know all about us, you know our loneliness, you know our difficulties, you know our issues. We thank you that we can cast all our cares upon you, because you care for us. We pray that as a fellowship, we'll continue to weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice. So we ask that you would continue with us now by your Spirit, through your word, instructing and encouraging us. For we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We sing again, and this time it's the more modern song describing God's sovereignty and his greatness. Who has held the ocean in his hands. Turn you to 2 Timothy chapter 1, and our text this evening is verse 12. That is why I am suffering as I am, yet I am not ashamed, because I know whom I believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to guard what I've entrusted to him until that day. But before we launch into the actual verse, let me remind you, by way of introduction, that this is a very poignant letter. In verse 2, Paul writes to Timothy, my dear son. Now, Timothy is not his real son, his flesh and blood son, but he is a spiritual son. He met him on his first missionary journey, and he took him under his wing, and he trained him. And now he's stepping into the apostle's shoes. It's a poignant, poignant letter. Father, spiritual father to spiritual son. And it's poignant, furthermore, for those who marry in the Lord and yet discover that they can't have children of their own. That's a great setback. That's a great trial. I've met many who have been in that position. But what has been a good response? That is the response whereby a couple dust themselves down and they say, well, if God can't give us natural children, when we'll have spiritual children. And they have opened their homes and their hearts, and they've become a spiritual father and a spiritual mother to those who haven't got Christian parents. That's certainly my experience. And there, when I came to faith at 16 years of age, I was so grateful for a spiritual grandma in the church, a Mrs. Beauville, and she would pray for me. She'd always ask me how my week had gone, and she was someone I could share my concerns and issues with in total confidence. And heaven will reveal the many spiritual sons and daughters that she had. A godly, godly mother. It's also a prison letter. We can see that, chapter 4 and verse 6. And Paul asks for material while he's in prison. And that's a reminder that life wasn't always easy. And it certainly wasn't a case of health and wealth when Paul became a Christian. No, he was persecuted, he was hounded. But he finished up having great spiritual health and great spiritual wealth as he shared the gospel. And you and I may not be favored financially or be very wealthy in this world's eyes, but we can know a spiritual wealth that the world can never take away. So beware of those who come along and speak of a prosperity gospel, but certainly rejoice in the spiritual treasures of the gospel. So it's a poignant letter and it is a prison letter, but it's also a daunting letter, because here is the Apostle Paul leaving Timothy to fill the apostle's shoes. When I was with Sazra, I followed a great man who'd been the area representative before me. And it was my task to go around churches and preach and tell of the work of Sazra. And I used to introduce myself in the early days. I said, well, for me to follow Mr. X is like Des O'Connor trying to follow Pavarotti. You know, I wasn't like him. It was just simple little old me. But, you know, if Timothy felt like that, and I'm sure he did, then Paul reminds him of the power of the gospel. I remind you, verse 6, to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. Verse 7, for the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. And every day, you and I, as believers, are to remind ourselves that if there is a task God wants us to do, he will equip us for it. Well, let's come to the text itself. Verse 12. I am not ashamed, because I know whom I've believed, and I'm convinced he's able to guard what I've entrusted to him until that day. First of all, we notice from this verse the confidence of Paul in the gospel. Now, earlier on in verse 8, he says, do not be ashamed of the testimony about the Lord or of me as prisoner. So, Timothy, don't be ashamed of the gospel and don't be ashamed of me. Why should he say that? Well, Paul is in prison now. He's writing from Rome. And if you've ever tried to help someone who's been in prison, you'll be aware of the stigma that is attached to such ex-prisoners. And many enemies of the gospel would be saying, well, it can't be much of a message if one of its great advocates is put in prison. So Paul says, don't be ashamed. I'm not in prison because I've broken any legitimate laws of the land. I'm in prison because of the gospel. And why is he so confident in the gospel? Well, because it is the power of God unto salvation. I am not ashamed of my chains, he says in verse 16. And while Paul was there in prison, I am sure he would reflect upon those who have come to the Lord Jesus and thereby encourage himself. Here is one passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 6 to 9. Why is Paul not ashamed of the gospel? He says, "Do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, or adulterers, or men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." You see what the apostle is saying? Don't be ashamed of the gospel, because what Roman military discipline couldn't do, what Greek philosophy couldn't do, the gospel did. It took these kinds of people, thieves and adulterers, and it changed them for the good. It gave them peace in their hearts. It gave them the wherewithal to live life as they should live it. Nothing else could have done this, but this so-called weak gospel, preached in the power of the Spirit, opened blind eyes and enabled people to see. So there in Corinth was a church which was a trophy to God's grace. I came across a little illustration of a couple of centuries ago where a military band was marching through the villages in this part of Italy, drumming up recruits. And you saw young men coming out of their houses with a sword or a rusty pistol and marching behind the band, all eager to join and be a soldier. And so the story goes, a housewife was suddenly seen there, and she'd come out in such a rush, still had her apron on, and she had a rolling pin over her shoulder, and she wanted to join. Of course, the onlookers began to laugh at her. What a sight! And she was obviously some woman, because she turned round to those who were laughing and said, "I don't mind you laughing, as long as you know in this war whose side I'm on, whose side I'm on." And I know that one of our burdens is that as you and I go around our neighbourhoods, as we live out our lives, we want people to know whose side we're on. The songwriter put it, "Ashamed of Jesus, soon afar, let evening blush to own a star. Don't let me be ashamed of the gospel. Forgive me when I am. Help me to not be ashamed." So Paul is confident in the gospel because he's seen it at work. And then secondly, we see the content of the gospel there in verse 12 onwards and verse 9. Because Paul can say what we've hinted at, he has saved us. He has saved us. Now, when I was on the factory floor as a printer, you know, especially when I was an apprentice, you'd get men who knew where I stood, and mostly good-humoured, they'd say, "Steve, Jesus saves, yeah? Well, can he save me a blonde or a brunette?" And the laughter would go up. But I'd say, "No, but he can save your soul." And we had good banter between us. Luke reminds us of the birth of Jesus. "You shall call his name Jesus because he'll save his people from their sins." And talk about being saved isn't popular today, even amongst church folk, is it? But it's such a vital word. We are lost, we're helpless, we need to be saved. I know an RAF pilot and is now a pastor in Blackburn in the northwest of England. I remember hearing his testimony and seeing some of it on film. He was one day flying out of Lincoln and in his jet, and suddenly there was a malfunction on the dashboard, and he had just a couple of seconds to decide whether to eject or not. He ejected, and just as well, because the plane exploded mid-air. He was saved. How thankful he was. He didn't mind the term that he'd been saved from such a death. Or there's a house fire and it's horrific and the flames are licking up the side of the house and there's a woman and child in her arms and she's crying out, "Save me." And what relief when the fire brigade arrive and they are saved. Or we were on holiday once and the next day we were by the sea, we heard of a woman in the same locality, and for 36 hours she'd hung on to her surfboard and she was so glad when the lifeboat crew got out and saved her. Well, here is the Apostle Paul, and he's saying that the gospel saves us from something worse than ejecting from a plane and smashing into mountains. Something much worse we're saved from drowning in the sea or in a burning house. We are saved from hell and saved to heaven. That's the reality of the situation. And Paul rejoices. Men and women have been saved in this life for their good and saved for the life to come. There's a great hymn which reminds us of the concern of the Lord Jesus that we be saved, that we see the danger, we don't laugh at it, and that we are saved. There lies beyond its shadow, but on the farther side, the darkness of an awful grave that gapes both deep and wide. But there between us stands the cross, two arms outstretched to save, like a watchman set to guard the way from that eternal grave. Have you known the gospel saving you? Have you known the joy that when death finally takes you, it won't be into that unending regret and remorse, but into an unending joy and gladness? But the gospel not only saves us, it continues to save us. It continues to save us. Are we made perfect when we're saved? No. There remains indwelling sin. And there's a battle between the Holy Spirit and the habits that we formed. So that's why we have 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. That when we sin, we are called upon to say, if we confess our sin, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So whatever kind of day you've had, if at the end of it we look back and see the words, the actions that have been wrong, we can come to God and with a contrite heart ask for his forgiveness, and he will cleanse us. He will make us clean. The doctors rejoice when sick people come because then they can make them better. And Jesus rejoices every time you come and you say, "Lord, I've sinned again," and he can wash us again. Some years ago, one Saturday morning, in fact, I was doing some little jobs and one of them was creosoting the garden fence. And because Linda was out, I took a shortcut. Instead of putting my overalls on, I had my best shorts on. None of you men would do that, of course. And I was whistling a merry tune, going right down this fence, and everything was fine. And almost with the last brush stroke, I caught something, and there was a spray of creosote on my fawn shorts. And immediately I thought, Linda, I'm in big trouble. Well, I went in the house, got out the water, got out the detergent, scrubbed and scrubbed. I got some of it off, but not all. So I hung them on the line. And as soon as I heard the car draw up, I was out there opening the door for Linda, taking out the bags, asking if she wanted a cup of tea. And then she said, what have you done wrong? And I told her. I didn't quite get the clip of the ear. But, you know, I was so stupid, wasn't I? I hadn't taken the precautions. And as Christians, we can be downright stupid. And we can do things. And afterwards we say, why did I say that, do that, think that? Yes, there's an ongoing battle. By and by, we overcome. But we'll never be perfect in this life. And God, therefore, has made provision to keep on saving us, to keep on washing us. His blood can make the foulest clean. And then we read that this gospel that saves us, part of being saved is we are called to be holy. Verse 9, called to be holy. He saved us and called us to a holy life. So we're not saved to continue as we were. We're saved to be holy. What is the will of God for us? Our sanctification. And Ephesians 4 verse 1 spells out, no filthy talk from our lips and so on. He's very elderly now, Joseph Ton, but he was a dynamic pastor in Romania at a time of revival. But he was brought in for interrogation more than once and encouraged to recant his faith. And he said to them on one occasion, he said, you know, you are trying to limit our growth, to refuse our applications for extensions to our church. But you're actually doing a foolish thing, because the work that we do as churches, Baptist churches in Romania, is that we give to the nation clean people, clean young people, clean middle-aged people, clean older people. That's what the gospel does. We're not what we should be, but we're not what once we were. So this morning, ask yourself, Lord, make me as holy as a redeemed sinner can be, because the gospel has saved us to be holy. And the gospel also goes on with a glorious destination. Verse 10 tells us, grace was given, but it's been revealed through the appearing of our Saviour Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Death is the human predicament, and many seek to not talk about it, and if they do talk about it, to try and remove the awfulness from it. Someone sent us on WhatsApp just last week a little clip, and it was a burial, and the coffin was in the grave, and the man who had died had requested that a recording be played of him asking to get out. And you could see a mixture of embarrassment and sort of laughter. It's nothing to laugh about, is it? People will try to put off the ultimate statistic that one out of one die. But what is the gospel? The gospel is that our God is the end of the journey, his pleasant and marvelous domain. For there, the children of mercy praise him for Calvary's pain. He has brought life and immortality to light in the gospel. So there's the content of the gospel there. And then there is communion with the God of the gospel. Because what Paul says, I am not ashamed because I know whom I believed. There's an intimacy here. Paul isn't just someone with head knowledge of Jesus, but he, in his heart, he knows the Lord Jesus Christ. There's intimacy. To know you is to love you. Just to see you smile makes my whole life worthwhile. Intimacy, a growing intimacy. A husband and wife are having their first anniversary. The lights are low, the food's on the table, candles are lit. And then the wife says, "Darling, do you love me like you did last year?" And he says, "No." And within a second, she's got the drawing pin out of the drawer and about to swish it across. And he says, "Wait, wait," he says, "you asked me, do I love you as last year?" And the answer is, "No, I love you more than I did last year." And that's the wonder of the gospel. He's brought me into his banqueting house, and his banner over me is love. I trust you can say there's a growing intimacy with the God of the gospel. As you use the means of grace, sometimes the Bible flashes with light. Sometimes it's hard and it's difficult. But over the years, using the means of God's grace, his word, fellowshipping together, hearing it preached, there grows an intimacy with our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 3 tells us, grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus. Alan Redpath and A.W. Tozer, an Englishman and an American, both used of God in his service, have a story about them. Tozer was in America, and Alan Redpath had gone across there to be involved with the Moody Bible Church. And Tozer rang him up one day and said, "Look, shall we meet together for prayer as fellow ministers?" And Alan Redpath said, "Yeah, that'd be great. So what time shall we meet?" And Tozer said, 5 o'clock in the morning. Alan Redpath took a gulp, tried to make it the normal time to get up, and said, "Yes, I'll meet you." And they did meet, and they did pray. And Alan Redpath had the grace to say later on that, "I didn't often go there. Not because we didn't get on well, he was a great help to me. But as I heard him pray, I felt I was something of an intrusion." It's a wonderful thing, isn't it, to be with Christians who have a growing intimacy with God. May that be true of you and of me. And then if we say there's the content of the gospel, being saved, being made holy, there's communion in the gospel, getting to know the Lord, my beloved is mine and I am his, then there's also commitment to the gospel here. I know whom I believed, and I'm convinced he's able to guard what I have entrusted to him. There's a commitment. Imagine you go to a hotel and you are given the option of paying a little extra to put your valuables in the safe. You'd be foolish not to. You want to commit what's valuable into a place that is safe. Now, that's what Paul did. He committed his soul to God and Jesus Christ. And so I ask you, what is the most valuable thing you've got? You might have a list, but the most valuable thing is your soul. And it would be a foolish thing to go another day without committing that fragile, eternal soul to God, to play with fire. Who knows when any of us might be taken? Or will you commit yourself, as the Apostle Paul did, as many of us have? Commit your soul to God, able to say, I know now who I believe, and I know that he'll keep my soul until that day. Oh, my friend, commit yourself to Jesus Christ. Don't delay another day longer. The commitment to the gospel. Lastly, then, there is the climax to the gospel, because he says, I've committed my soul to him, that is God, until that day. Well, what day does he mean? He means the final day of judgment, the day when the dead in Christ will rise, when those who have preceded us will come down in the air, and we shall be forever with the Lord. Don't forget that day. There are many hard days until that day. So Paul says, don't forget that day. The crowning day is coming. It's coming by and by, when our Lord will come with power and glory from on high. Or that glorious sight will dazzle each waiting, watching eye. Or the crowning day is coming. It's coming by and by. Are you looking forward to that great day? I made reference to my days as a printer, and I remember one day that my foreman was going around the unit like a bear with a sore head. He was usually an affable guy, pleasant to work with, but there was something not quite right. And I was about 18, 19 years of age, and we were together just after five. The hooter had gone, the day was ended, and we were washing the ink off our hands, he and I together, using the same sink. And he said, Steve, he says, if you ever get married, let me give you some advice. Never forget the wedding anniversary. And that's why he'd been off that day. He'd gone out of the house with a flea in his ear, because he had no card, nothing to celebrate his wedding day. And he must have been a good 30 years married. Well, he made good and on the way home bought the necessary gifts and cards. Very easy though, isn't it? I know it, you know it, to forget that day. But it's going to come. 1 in 9 verses in the New Testament refer to the coming of our Lord Jesus. People mock it, but they need to bear in mind that in the Old Testament it was said that Messiah would come, where he would come, the events surrounding his coming. Matthew 1, chapters 3 to 5, Matthew 1 to chapter 3 tell us how explicitly those events happened. He came the first time, so it's logical to believe he'll come the second time. I wish we'd all been ready. There was a sound of guns and war, people lying on the floor. Oh, I wish we'd all been ready. A man and wife asleep in bed. He hears a noise and turns his head. She's gone and he's left behind. Oh, I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind. Oh, my dear friend, there's no need to be. Here is confidence in the gospel. It's the solution to all the ills in the world and society. The content of the gospel, it will save you. It'll make you holy. It'll lead you into an intimacy with God. And the climax to this gospel, for those who commit themselves, they'll be able to say, it is well with my soul. May God so bless his word that this day you'll say, yes, I'm going to believe in my heart and I'm going to confess with my lips that Jesus Christ is Lord. Heavenly Father, then we just pause and ask that you would take your word, wing it into our hearts. Encourage us and save us, we pray. For Jesus' sake, amen. We'll sing once more and then just come back for a short benediction. Or teach me what it meaneth, that cross uplifted high.
Yeah.
benediction is from Romans 15 and verse 13. And now, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen, and thank you for joining us. Until next time, take care.